Good evening and thank you for joining us. This is our daily edition of the news, 10 minutes of the news, old school style, to give you a lowdown of everything that happened today. Of course, there's no debate, there's no opinion, there's no noise, there's no fuss. It's just the news, which is why we've called it Just the News. All right, let's get straight to it. Our first story for today, the Union Cabinet has approved a proposal to impose President's rule in Puducherry days after the Congress-led government of the Union Territory lost power during a vote of confidence. Announcing the Cabinet decision, Union Minister Prakash Javdekar told reporters that the decision was taken as no party came forward to claim to form a government in the Union Territory. This is, of course, after the resignation of Congress Chief Minister V. Narayan Swamy. Now, Javdekar has also said the model code of conduct will be expected to come into place fairly soon after the Election Commission announces dates for the election there and for four other states. India's vaccination drive is now going to enter its next phase in March. People above the age of 60 and those above the age of 45 who have comorbidities, which means diseases like high blood pressure or a heart problem, things like that, will be vaccinated starting the 1st of March. Now, here's where there's a slight difference in the vaccination program so far. Union Minister Prakash Javdekar has said the central government will rope in 10,000 government clinics and 2,000 private clinics for the vaccination starting the 1st of March. The vaccination will be given free of cost at government hospitals, but the cost of the vaccine at private hospitals is yet to be decided by the health ministry. So basically this means, putting it very simply, that a lot of people, including all of our parents, can get vaccinated and they will be able to basically book an appointment at a private clinic or hospital, make a payment and get that vaccination. The first phase of the COVID vaccination drive in India, which was started on the 16th of January, has now been completed. The government has also sent 10 teams to 10 states and union territories as COVID cases are now surging in the country. The health ministry has said that while cases in the states of Chhattisgarh, Gujarat, Kerala, Maharashtra, Madhya Pradesh, Punjab and Jammu and Kashmir were rising, the proportions of the high accuracy RT-PCR tests in these states was also falling. So the three-member multidisciplinary teams have been sent to all of these states and the centre has also asked these states to increase the RT-PCR testing and carry out both kinds of tests in a focused manner in their worst affected districts. Also, the slum of Dharavi in Mumbai has reported 10 cases yesterday, entering double digits for the first time in a while. In Uttar Pradesh, Uttar Pradesh's assembly has cleared a contentious bill prohibiting conversion from one religion to another through marriage. Prohibition of the Unlawful Religious Conversion Bill 2021 was passed by the assembly by a voice vote. It will replace the ordinance that was already in place. The bill will now be sent to the upper house and then to the governor for his nod before it becomes an act. Remember, this is the contentious Love Jihad law. Also, the Punjab and Haryana High Court has posted labour rights activist Nodeep Kaur's bail plea for the 26th of February. The court has also directed the state of Haryana to record the subsequent medical report. Now, to give you some context, Nodeep Kaur is a young woman who is an activist specifically for the rights of labour workers. Now, she was arrested on the 12th of January when she was protesting with labourers at the Kundli border point between Delhi and Haryana. Now, this protest demanding higher wages coincided with the ongoing farmers' protest against the three central laws and was in solidarity with the farmers' protest as well. She was charged with murder, extortion, theft, rioting, unlawful assembly and criminal intimidation. In her bail plea, Nodeep Kaur has said that she was severely beaten up by the police in the police station after her arrest in Sonipat last month, and that her medical examination was not conducted, and that's a violation of Section 54 of the Criminal Procedure Code. Pictures of white toxic foam on the surface of the Yamuna River near Delhi's ITO have surfaced on Tuesday. The pictures show that the froth, which is apparently caused by toxic chemicals, pollutants and untreated waste, has also covered the entire bank. Now, the Delhi government has been talking about various plans to improve the quality of the water in the Yamuna and reduce exactly this sort of toxicity. But what we're seeing right now, obviously, visuals from today show that there's much left to be done in this area. Moving on now to business news, Airtel has decided to enter the ad tech industry. Now, apparently in this move, which is called Airtel Ads, the move will enable brands to pitch consent-based, privacy-safe campaigns to over 320 million customers of Airtel in various businesses like their mobile, DTH and homes. However, Airtel has promised that it won't spam its users. Elon Musk is no longer the richest man in the world. He's now the second richest man in the world after Jeff Bezos. Now, this is after Tesla shares fell 9%, losing a whopping $15 billion of his fortune. Now, this very steep fall came a week after Tesla announced its risky investment of $1.5 billion into Bitcoin. And it was after the company made that investment that Elon Musk tweeted saying Bitcoin prices seem high. And as well, of course, Tesla's decision to halt orders on the cheaper version of its Model Y SUV. Musk's net worth is now estimated at $183 billion. Jeff Bezos is worth $186 billion. Let's take a look now at sports news. All eyes are on Ahmedabad, where India and England are now playing their third test match. But some news about the stadium itself. The cricket stadium in Motera has been now named the Narendra Modi Stadium. President Ramnath Kovind inaugurated the newly revamped cricket stadium in Ahmedabad, and it was named after the Prime Minister Narendra Modi. The cricket stadium in Motera is the largest cricket stadium in the world, with a capacity of 1.3 lakh people in the audience. Home Minister Amit Shah announced that it can now host two different games in the same day. The stadium was inaugurated in the presence of Gujarat Governor Acharya Devart, Sports Minister Kiran Rijiju, and BCCI Secretary Jay Shah. In other sports news that also coincides with politics, cricketer Manoj Tiwari joined the TMC in presence of West Bengal Chief Minister Mamata Banerjee in Hooghly on Wednesday. Actors Kanchan Mulak, June Malia, Shayoni Ghosh also joined the TMC today. West Bengal is headed for election, as you know, in April and May this year. American golfer Tiger Woods has undergone emergency surgery to repair significant damage to his right leg and ankle after a car crash in California on Tuesday. Woods had multiple open fractures affecting his right tibia and his fibula, the main bones in his lower leg. The bones have now been stabilized by inserting a rod into the tibia. That's what the doctors have said. Woods' team has said the golfer is awake, responsive, and recovering in his hospital room after the surgery. And positive news, because some of you had asked for some pieces of positive news, we'll end on a positive note. Indian activist Anjali Bhardwaj wins an anti-corruption champions award awarded by the US. Anjali Bhardwaj, working on issues of transparency and accountability, is among 12 people being honored by the US government with the new International Anti-Corruption Champions Award. According to the State Department, Bhardwaj served as an active member of the Right to Information movement in India for over two decades. She is the founder of the Satrak Nagarik Sangathan, the citizens group with a mandate to promote transparency and accountability in government. The award is meant to recognize individuals who worked tirelessly, often in the face of adversity, to defend transparency, combat corruption, and ensure accountability in their own countries. Anjali Bhardwaj, there, many congratulations to her. That brings us to the end of our bulletin tonight. Remember, leave us a comment and your feedback on how we can improve this offering for you and how we can make it better. But for now, thanks for watching and good night.